And we're back, ladies and gentlemen, live on the Philippe Matthews Show. Thank you for tuning in wherever you are in the world. Today is a day of history. Today is a historical, unprecedented day. I am here with Dr. Myran Haley. She spent most of her early childhood in South Charleston, West Virginia, before her parents moved her and the family to Columbus, Ohio. While she was in Columbus, Ohio, she earned her doctorate in communications in African-American studies, and met Alex Haley. And this is just the most wonderful love story you're going to ever hear. But it's also a story about our history and how two beautiful Black people came together and literally made history. Dr. Myran Haley, thank you for being with me today.
Thank you. Thank you, Philip. I got my PhD at Ohio State in communications. With a minor in Black studies.
Okay, gotcha. Thank you for that correction. And somebody needs to change that on the website. Okay.
I think the old system where you had to write in a major and a minor.
Gotcha. Understood. So we, you know, you and I have had many conversations, and I love you. I call you my mystical mother. What I love is you telling the story of how you and Alex met, and the love story of working together to produce this unprecedented work. Can you take us back to you saw Alex doing a speech? Is that right?
Well, what happened was, I was in my apartment, and I was going over my notes because the next day I was to defend my dissertation for my PhD. And this friend stopped by and he said, Alex Haley's going to be speaking tonight. And I'm going, oh, what do I do? What do I do? And let me grab my purse. Okay. And so we took off. And it was like a huge auditorium. And it was packed, all that. People were lining the walls. And this very humble guy, you know, comes with the tortoiseshell glasses and everything. He, within minutes, he had us all galvanized. Alex spoke in a certain rhythm, but he never really raised his voice or anything. The passion came through the timbre of his speech. People were popping up like popcorn, you know, it was like electrifying because people had no idea of their connections and their history like that. And so when Alex finished, which was 2.5 hours later, he had spoken without a note, I thought, well, I'll just go up and shake his hand and tell him that he needs me as an assistant, right? I couldn't get within miles of the man. And so I sent him my resume through a friend of his, and nothing happened for weeks. I got so depressed. I was invested in depression because I knew I was supposed to help this man. And then finally, I got to my office one day, and you know, there's always a kind of cheerleader in the office. Mm-hmm. And this was our receptionist, and she was holding this yellow envelope. Closer, I could see an H in the corner, and then I could see an A in the corner. And at the time, I was the only person who had ever been allowed to be the assistant to the vice president of the entire university. He was the executive vice president. And so he came out, and if he hadn't put a chair under my butt, I would have hit the floor. So he took the envelope and opened it, and Alex was asking me to come to Jamaica, where he was living. Well, actually, he was hiding out at the time, but he was living in Jamaica where he was working on Roots. Well, sometimes it's hard to get what you deserve, what you feel you want, because at the same time, that very same day, I had gone home to my apartment to lunch, and there in my post office box was a letter from Harvard University offering me a position.
Wow.
Yeah.
Did not know that.
I turned it down summarily. And without any, Alex couldn't promise me any money, anything that Harvard could promise me and did promise me. I got on that plane, Air Jamaica, on my way to see him.
What?
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
And Harvard came back to me three times, you know, with different things.
Really?
You know, we'll give you this, we'll give you that. And I'm going, no, I am packing. I didn't even have a suitcase, though. And then, you know, I'm going to Jamaica, and all I got is polyester clothes, right? So I get to Jamaica.
I don't even know what polyester is today. I know I do. Lord knows I know I do.
I was cooking in that heat and that humidity. But Alex, I met him.
But wait a minute. What, you know, now, obviously I hear the passion, but what in Alex and you in this work caused you to turn down Harvard? I mean, that's a big deal on the same day, and you didn't even think twice about it.
I had never even spoken to Alex Haley. I did not know that I would have a job with Alex Haley before I turned down Harvard three times.
Wow.
Yeah, because I just had a sense that my destiny lay with Alex, something that I was supposed
to. You have been in tune all your life.
I feel as though, you know, I was directed.
You have that gift, my God.
And when the plane landed in Jamaica, it was like I let everybody else get off the plane because it was like, oh, my God, going to meet your destiny is like you just don't know, you know. But he was wonderful. And we talked about our grandmothers. And growing up in the South together and all that kind of thing, on our way from Montego Bay, where the plane landed, to his cottage, which was Whitehall Cottage on Negril. Negril was the 7 miles of white, white sand in crystal blue water. You could stand in it up to your chin and count your toes. That's how clear it was.
Wow.
Yeah, and it was like count them, 12 steps from his back door, right? And so I'm thinking, wow, this is going to be great, right? And so we had this lunch together that his housekeeper made, and it was wonderful. It was yellowtail and, you know, the food of the tropics. And then he said, well, let me show you the problem that I have. He said, I am a little behind in my writing for Roots, and the screenwriters are getting a little bit annoyed, and the publisher is a little bit upset because I have missed the last 15 deadlines.
I didn't mean to bust out like that, Maya. I'm so sorry.
He took me into his office, and Philip, there were stacks of yellow copy paper, you know, where Alex had done, you know, this draft and that draft and trying to put things together for the last 2/3 of the book. And they stood as tall as me. And I'm sitting there, I'm going, this man is nuts.
Mad scientist, literally.
It was crazy. And so as I sat there, smelling the mango and the papaya, and the breadfruit hanging low in the trees, and hearing the reggae music and the waves fingering in off the water and onto the beach and everything, I'm thinking, oh my God, what have we got here? I mean,
and what have I gotten myself into?
Yeah, but what happened was, see, Alex had he had been working for 12 years to finish the first third of Roots.
And really? 12 years?
12 years. Because, remember, he had to assemble all this information. He had to travel. He had to do all these things to congeal all this information. And then he had to write from Kunta in Africa, and he was able to get him, Kunta, to Annapolis. He had gotten them through the Middle Passage into Annapolis. And that's when we met. So it was like the last 2/3 of the book. And so he was in a crunch. I mean, we're talking about a major vice, you know, where you put two pipes together and squeeze them, you know.
Oh my God.
It was
12 years of work and 15 missed deadlines.
More than that, Philip. I you know, more than that. And more than that. I mean, everybody was mad at Alex. His ex-wives, who hadn't been getting any checks from him, you know, because the man didn't have any money. And and so we started this process of working together. And then after a while, and this was on the last two-thirds of the book, from Annapolis all the way to the end of the book. And at a point, Jamaica began to have some problems, to the point that people were waking up and folks were having their hands cut off by machetes, you know, and people who were.
Oh, wow.
It was scary. And so one night I woke up.
So this is 1976 somewhere?
No, this was 75.
75, okay.
Early 75. I woke up when I said, and I went out and I said to Alex, we've got to leave here. Now. We packed up in the middle of the night and took all of our stuff to Montego Bay, where we got a plane to New York. Now, Alex called a friend of his in New York, who had an apartment there, and made an arrangement with her that she would come to his cottage in the Grill on the beach, and we would take her apartment in order to finish the book and be close to the publisher. What his friend did not tell us was that we arrived in New York in one of the worst winters that New York had seen at that time, dragging all of our stuff, and she had no heat.
Oh, Lord.
So we had all of our clothes on.
Oh, no.
And so what Alex did was he cut the fingers off my gloves so that I could keep typing and keep working.
Oh, my God.
We also had no money. And so he got this speaking engagement. Somehow, he was able to get a plane out to Iowa, where he was supposed to speak to this group, and he did. And he sent money back to me. And, you know, I'm going in the kitchen. The only way I can even get any warmth is to turn on the jets on the stove and put my hands over it, you know, my gloves over it, and then go back and work some more. He finally got me the money, and the taxi cab driver arrived. So here I am. I was 98 pounds soaking wet, right? So I'm dragging out the IBM Selectric typewriter. I'm dragging out all the drafts. I'm dragging out all of our clothes. I'm dragging out all of our stuff, you know? And he's sitting in the car, warm as he can be, going, oh, you know, he's popping his fingers off. I'm stuffing this stuff in his trunk. Well, he finally got me to the Drake Hotel, and I'm thinking, God bless. So the bellman there took my stuff to my room, and I only had a little bit of money after I checked in and paid for the room. And so I went down, you know, underneath, you know, where the restaurants are, you know, the fast food places. Mm-hmm. And so I was able to get a tuna sandwich, a stuffed tuna sandwich, that I was able to cut into four pieces because I knew Alex would be back in 4 days. I cut it four pieces. And I didn't have enough money for anything else. But the guy whose shop it was gave me a large copy. And so when I got back to the hotel room, I drew a line, four lines on the cup, so that I'd know how much coffee I could drink for 4 days.
Oh, my gosh.
And that's all I had to keep working. And I worked until Alex could get back. And then when he got back, it was a major snowstorm. I mean, big, fat flakes of snow. And Alex said, let's go down to the corner at Chock Full of Nuts and, you know, just have a break. And I'm going, what? My shoes were like cardboard. I didn't have anything, you know, decent shoes. Neither did he. So we go slogging through the snow. And, you know, pretty soon, you know, it didn't take long before, you know, our feet were wet and whatnot. Anyway, we arrived at Chapel and Nuts. And there was nobody in there. It's the middle of the night in a snowstorm.
Sure.
And so the waitress, was coming toward us with a coffee pot, and but something happened with Alex, and the waitress stopped, and so did I, because as we were looking at Alex, I tell you the truth, there were these kind of sparklies around him. Hmm. He took a napkin and his green pen, because he only wrote in green pen to let the universe know that he wanted some money. Mm. And he wrote in green pen the last paragraph of Roots. And then when he finished, the waitress brought us our coffee, and then we went back to the hotel. I typed it up, and the next day I delivered Roots to Doubleday.
Unbelievable. That's the best story ever. I don't think anybody knew. You know, you always see the after, mm-hmm. right? You always see, oh, it was an overnight success. Oh, it was great. I just wrote the book. And they just wrote the book. And my God, I had no idea. You guys really struggled on so many levels. You didn't have money.
Starving.
You had already exhausted your time, so you really didn't have any time.
We had nothing. And then in this lady's apartment, I was there 3 days freezing my butt off because she had no heat. It was a lovely apartment, but there was no heat. And I'm sitting there trying to type, you know, and trying to work on the material. And I had the blankets over me. I had practically everything that I owned that I had put on, you know, in order to try to keep warm, to keep going.
Wow. What was your process, your writing process like? I mean, you know, a lot of people think now, oh, well, she had, you know, computers and all that. No, she didn't. Oh, she had a tablet. No, she didn't. Because none of that stuff was invented. Smartphones, all of that stuff, nothing. This is hardcore, old school, sit down at the typewriter and type. Walk us through that process, because I don't think too many, I remember, but I don't think too many people today would even know what that looks like.
Well, because Alex was always the author, and I was always the apprentice. You know, I would, you know, do draft work, and because I had just graduated my PhD and I had, you know, black studies and all that, I mean, it was right at the top of my head. So pretty much everything he needed, you know, I was drafting this stuff. He was coming back and he was working through it. And Alex might do one chapter 15 times, you know, we'd talk it, we'd play act it. We'd, you know, I would be Belle, the big house cook, and he would be Kunta, or I would be, he would be Chicken George, you know, and we'd play act it until we got that right down, just the right way. And what was nice about it was my grandmother had the dialect, and his grandmother had the dialect. And so, you know, both of us were able to put all of that together, you know, in our combined histories and experiences. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And so, yeah, we were able to make that happen, but it was not easy. And not only that, Alex was the greatest procrastinator in the world. He made me so upset. I mean, we're under the gun, right? I mean, we're getting telegrams from everybody, you know, saying you've got to get this stuff in, you know, and the postmistress is arriving by donkey, right? And she's got this stack of telegrams from but because of my training as a PhD candidate, it was like, okay, this is what you do. Okay, this is the log for today. This is exactly what we're going to do, and this is what we're going to achieve. This is how many chapters we're going to be able to finish, and all of that. And Alex said, you know, I think we ought to go to the fish market in Saint Lamar. What?
Oh, my gosh. You guys were a perfect balance for each other.
The man made me so crazy. Oh, when I would get on, I would sit his table out on the veranda. I would have the coffee there. I would have his pens there. Everything is ready. I'm ready to talk about the copy and everything. Alex would disappear in the bathroom.
Oh my God.
I'm thinking 15 minutes, 20 minutes, 30 minutes. I'm banging on the bathroom door. Come out of there. Let's get to work. He's sitting in there reading a magazine. You need to relax. And I'm thinking, relax. We just received 20 milligrams, That's the way it was.
Wow. All right. So all the while, amidst all of this frenetic chaos, you guys fell in love.
Yeah, but it was gradual.
Was it love? Because was it love at first sight, Mai, or was it love of the man's work and who he was at first sight, and then the love kind of happened? I mean, you were in Montego Bay and La Grille. I mean, you're in Jamaica. It's hard not to fall in love in Jamaica.
Well, that's true, but what happened was I carried with me hero worship from when I was even an undergraduate student, because I had read the autobiography of Malcolm X, and there was a disc jockey in our community. His name was Les Brown, and Les would come on his radio show, and he would talk about, I am somebody. And
this is not the same Les Brown. The motivational speaker.
Yeah, that's Les.
Are you serious?
Yeah,
oh, this is great history. Oh my gosh. Okay. Well, I consider him one of my forefathers. Okay, go for it.
He was phenomenal. He changed the awareness of a whole state, if not more. But I would listen to Les as I was driving to campus, and he would always talk about, I am somebody. And he was always giving some inspirational talk, and he was talking about Malcolm X. And I was reading the autobiography of Malcolm X, and it helped to change my life, because my background was poor. And I came from an inner city school. And so when I got to Ohio State, I didn't have the means to compete with those white kids who came from Arlington. I was still answering the questions in the back of the book, and they were writing essays, Mm-hmm. But because of what Les was saying, and because of what I was reading in the autobiography, I just felt like there was nothing I could do. And then later when I was in graduate
school. Have you ever told Les Brown this story?
I haven't had a chance to talk to Les. He left Columbus. I left Columbus.
I'll send this to him personally.
Yeah.
My gosh. And his son. Unbelievable. Okay.
Les was phenomenal. I mean, he really changed.
Les Brown inspired Dr. Myran Haley, people. This is amazing.
Incredible.
Unbelievable.
Les would talk about different kinds of spiritual books and whatnot. And there was a certain area in Columbus where he would go, after his radio show sometimes, where it was a little creek. It was a little tiny secluded park in a little creek. And, Les, who was always vivacious, and he was always out there and gregarious for other people. The couple of times that Les took me there, he was very insular. He reminded me of someone very Christ-like, who just sat there by the water, and he talked to me about the things that inspired him, But when he got on the radio, he was out there, and he helped to change a consciousness. He truly did, and so. I was reading the autobiography of Malcolm X, and then when I was in graduate school, my fellowship had to do with counseling undergraduate students. I can't tell you how many students, black and white, who came through my office with a dog-eared copy of the autobiography of Malcolm X, and to a man and woman, including myself, we were all changed in the chapter where Malcolm was in solitary confinement, and he decided to reinvent himself, and he got a dictionary from the guard, and he started with aardvark. Every single one of us was changed by that. And so when I met Alex, I had all of that history as well.
Mm-hmm. And Alex obviously added to that because he was just as amazing in his own life and his story and his work. He was a perfect male between Malcolm and Les Brown in a sense.
He was, but you know, Alex was a very simple guy. You know, we tend to think of him, you know, in big letters and you know, with the things that he did, but he was a simple guy. He was funny. You know, he loved to eat. You know, he had Southern tastes. The man started out in the morning thinking about what he was going to eat all day.
Is that right?
All day.
Well, it probably helped, too, because I know for a fact that you are one of the best cooks in the world. And so you probably didn't help him there too badly there. That was probably real easy for him to do since he had Dr. Myran Haley that was cooking that good food.
Alex was a great cook, remember? He was a cook in the Coast Guard, and that's how he got his start as a writer. So I didn't have to cook for Alex. Alex cooked for me.
Nice. Wow, this is great. Okay.
But see, Alex and I ate very, very differently. Alex ate Southern. I ate healthy. You know, I mean, he teased me saying that I ate grass, but you know, while he was eating lard, you know.
You know, hey, I understand it. I get it. It's that's our history. That's who we are.
Absolutely, you know, absolutely. The man loved to eat, and he was just funny. You know, we'd be driving up.
How did he propose?
He said, "Well, you know, we've been working together. We're doing pretty good, and you know, I think we work. And you know, what do you think about maybe spending the rest of our lives together? And you know, we can do this a little bit more in some other projects." And I'm going, "Okay."
There it is, ladies and gentlemen.
He said, "Why don't you go downtown and buy yourself a ring? And whatever you like is fine with me." And I'm going, "Okay."
This is great. Now, this is what? 76? Or when did you guys get engaged?
76, yeah. 76.
Mm-hmm. So, take me through the process now that, okay, you guys are engaged, and the book is now at the publishers, finally.
Right.
What happens after that? How did the book from the publisher become the miniseries?
Oh, it was happening concurrently.
Okay.
Because Alex was so late with everything, the book and the teleplays were being done at the same time.
Ah, all right.
The absolutely fabulous screenwriter, Ernie Canoy, was writing and directing the screenplays. The man was incredible. And so all of that was happening at the same time. When it was delivered, they were already in process of making it happen. And so it just simply exploded. And then Alex, who had a blue suit and a brown suit, and they were both threadbare. He had a pair of black shoes with a hole in the bottom that we painted with Shinola shoe polish so you couldn't see the hole. And he would pack it with newspaper, and he had a pair of brown ones that we did the same thing. And then suddenly, you know, I was thrust into getting this man new clothes. And so a friend of ours, fortunately, took me to this place in Beverly Hills where I could say, this is what he needs. And he was outfitted within a day, new clothes. Yeah. And he was on the road that very same day.
How did life, you know, that's obviously the big question. How did life change for you? Because both of you guys were struggling. You seemingly struggled even more than Alex. And so all of a sudden, you know, in a sense, you kind of went from rags to riches.
Well, I went from rags to rags, you know, because, you know, I had absolutely no fashion sense whatsoever. I arrived with a green dress and a red dress and a pair of maroon wedgies and a pair of ballerina flats. And that's all I had, really. And so I you know, and what what the studio wanted was information for, because they were doing Roots 2. And so I was working on that while he was out speaking. And I would wake up with people saying, I would open the blinds, and there were people going at the blinds. And they walked out on the porch. And at first, you know, it frightened me, and I called the police. And the police would bust them out. But by noon, they'd be back. And so finally, I just served coffee and sandwiches.
I love this. This is great. That is great. The paparazzi, she said, the press and the people, she's serving coffee and crumpets too. Oh, this is fantastic, Mom.
People thought that all they had to do was touch Alex's hem, you know, and they would be made whole in some way.
What was that like? I mean, you know, all celebrities I talk to, it's you know, fame is something that you can't control. It's not something you can put in a box. It's not even, you can hire the best publicists, you can hire the best gatekeepers and managers. But fame, when people get in this, the mindset of who this person is, you can't control that. How did you adjust, and how did Alex adjust to fame? Because that's different than money.
Alex was really good. And the only time that I heard from him that he was disconcerted was he was coming through some airport somewhere when this woman saw him and fell on the floor and started kissing his shoes. And he said, "Oh, honey, get up from there. Please don't do that. Get up from there."
Oh my God,
this woman. Oh, you know, that was the only time, you know, but he handled it very, very well.
Now, you're saying Alex handled it very, very well, but you haven't said anything about how Ma handled it.
Well, you know, I was always in the background, so okay. I didn't really have to handle it all that much. As long as I served coffee and sandwiches, I was fine.
I love you so much. Okay. So
nobody knew who I was.
So here you are now with Roots. Did either of you think that it would become a worldwide phenomenon as big as it did, as quick as it did?
Alex did not. He was just trying to get the job done. But I remember sitting on the veranda and saying to him, "Alex, the world has just shifted, and you need to get ready." And he's going, "Yeah, what's for dinner?" You know, I'm saying, "Listen, you need to pay attention to me." I said, "It's coming." It's like, "Yeah, okay." Yeah, there's no way you could possibly know.
Yeah, absolutely. The finale, I think, hit 100, the largest. The record has not been broken. 100 million viewers. Unbelievable. It's been 38 years, Mai. And they are now, the History Channel is rebooting the miniseries. And I found out something very startling from you. And that was that, and I read this in I think it was Variety. And they said that the network's execs, the producers will, you know, work closely with historians and other experts to incorporate new information about the historical period uncovered since the original book and miniseries were released. And they have not called you, yet it's in production. Excuse me, hello, History Channel, what are you doing? What's going on here? This doesn't make any sense. How is that even possible?
Well, I don't know, Philip, but they must not need my information. You know, they must have all they need. I don't know. I'm just grateful that they're doing it, you know, whether they need me or not.
Unreal. That is amazing to me. I just don't know how you do such. I don't know how you do that. How this is, as you said, the world shifted. Literally, the world shifted.
Yeah.
Black lives and white lives changed. It was one of the most enlightening authentic moments in Black history, especially after, we were still just, you know, recently after Civil Rights Movement, the loss of Martin Luther King, all of that wasn't that long ago, from 1977 to 68 when King was assassinated. And here comes this miniseries that tells about our history in a way that we have never seen, ever on television, in the movies, in any other form or medium. Here we are 38 years later, and they're not even calling you to say, hey, guess what? We're remaking it. How you doing?
Just because, you know, I worked on it.
Don't they know they would get some crumpets and some coffee, at least at the minimum? Don't you know that?
You know what I did was this was even before I knew that they were doing a remake of Roots. I sat down and wrote a one-man show that tells Alex's story from when he grew up in Henning, Tennessee, and hearing the story from the old ladies on the porch all the way to the end of his life. I have just submitted that to one of the studios. So I don't know, you know, if they do it, it will be a wonderful companion piece. You know, if they choose to do it. You know, because I don't think about things like that. You know, about being left out. I just simply did something else.
Well, I appreciate you because you're just such a humble a person. I'm not humble. I'm upset about the History Channel, and I'm letting everybody know on live video, and it's going to be on YouTube forever. History Channel, get off your butt, pick up the phone, call Dr. Myran Haley, and let them know that you, and have her be a part of something. Because she and her late husband wrote this thing. This is her baby. This is what, you know, so just do the right thing, History Channel. Do the right thing. We talked about the positive impact that Roots had on everyone, but especially us, Black folk. You know, did you go through some, I know there had to have been some backlash as well. Was there some negatives that came with the positives?
Yeah. I can remember, a lot of different, not a lot, a few different groups that approached Alex as having not been acknowledged or something in the way that they wanted to be and stuff like that. But by and large, Alex was so comprehensive in the way of the man. He was just, he was open, he was humble, and he put it all out there. That it was really hard to stay mad at him for just about anything, you know? Mm-hmm. And so even these groups, you know, I remember a couple of them coming to the house, you know, when they treated me like the maid, you know, while I'm serving them coffee and whatnot. I didn't care.
Wow.
You know, they were talking to Alex about, you know, but by the end of the evening, they were all on one accord. You know, you can hardly stay mad at Alex because he really didn't have any extra grind with you. You know, he was just giving you his heart. He was giving you what he was. That's all. So how can you be mad?
You know, I so appreciate you sharing that because I think a lot of times, most times, we get labeled the angry Black man or the angry Black woman whenever we talk about our history. And it's not, I mean, of course it's emotional, but it's also factual. And in a sense, you and Alex were just the scientists of that time to put together this work and just be authentic with it and put it out there without emotion. The, hey, this is it. This is how it happened. This is real. Mm-hmm. Where do you think the anger... Is there a place for, I mean, is there a place for the anger? Or should we move into a state or a place of really receiving the facts and knowing and owning our history? Where are you with that?
I remember being a fresh graduate and saying to Alex, why are you not angry? You know, and how can you not be angry? And, you know, writing this stuff. He said, how can you be so full of emotion and write effectively? He said,
wow.
I do that, you know? He said, I have to write what I know, but if I have so much emotion it's overpowering me, then that's coloring. That's my personal coloring. And I don't want to do that, you know? And so I learned that from him. And so we have all of these things that we need to be disturbed about, certainly, you know? But we also need to not stay there. That's what I'm saying. You can be really ticked off, but don't stay there. Yeah, mm-hmm. I remember this one lady, I can't even pronounce her name, she's on Oprah show, but she used to say, you can have basement moments, but just don't stay there.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. It's like, yeah, acknowledge that, but come out of it and do something else.
I love that. Thank you for that. So here we are today, and you know, the blessing is that this is being remade, and that history is being remade again, and hopefully we'll create a new history because it's an entirely new generation.
Right.
You told me a story about a young man. Well, we talked about it earlier, I think when we were in the green room. You were talking about this young man who came up to you and said, hey, was slavery really that bad?
Right.
When you told me, I lost my breath. I have asthma. I had to go get my inhaler and take a puff because I was just out of breath. You hear what I said? I was out of breath. Okay. I just couldn't even fathom somebody saying that was slavery that bad, 339 years of chattel slavery. What? When you hear, when you heard that from that young man, and this was a college child. This kid was in college.
A young black man who was a master's degree student.
A master's degree student. My God. Okay, so we have some work to do. Something happened, Mai. Something happened. When I was coming up, I'm turning 50 this month. When I was coming up, Roots was it. That was a definition. That was a platform. It was kind of like what happened with you with reading Malcolm X. So it was for us. That's what Roots was to us, right? Okay. What happened in the last 38 years that the kids of today, and I'm not saying for all kids, but I'm saying the fact that there is just one kid, which is too many, to right. say, is slavery really that bad? What happened? What did we do?
There's a disconnect where history is not personal. When history becomes just dates and data, I remember after one speech, one young man came up to me and said, you know that guy, the guy who did the marches? I said, you mean Martin Luther King? Oh, yeah, that guy.
I'm going, wow.
You know, it's a disconnect. It's a lack of personal attachment because we were on the front lines. You know, we have some personal relationship to that period of history. And others now, these young people, you know, on their devices are looking at this as, you know, isn't this a great documentary? Isn't this nice? You know, we can read about this guy named Malcolm X and, you know, and all of that. When there is a personal disconnect, that's kind of what you have. And my fault with this young man who said, is slavery all that bad, was I was so astounded by his remark that I did not take that as an opportunity to have a discussion with this guy, to talk with him about our personal history. Mm-hmm. I did not use it as a heuristic device to help to educate him.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was just simply standing there going, what? You know?
As I was when I heard it, exactly. Right. It's one of those things. Yeah.
Conversations need to happen. Like when I was speaking in Houston at this huge church, humongous church, you know, and they would say, well, what needs to happen, you know, that we can connect our, you know, what do we need to do? It's like, what? Everybody can do something. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter that whether it's a big thing or a little thing, it's something. You know, whether it's talking to your grandchild about, you know, about your history, whether it's educating your a neighbor child about how to cook a certain food that came out of slavery, talking about the music of the time, everybody can do something in terms of helping us to re-relate to the tapestry, which is our colorful history.
Love that. Thank you for that. Absolutely. So here we are with the first, you know, I never thought it would happen, but you live long enough and you see the first black president of the United States.
Right.
which was, you know, I remember, I, you know, it's one of those things, like, you know, when Martin Luther King died or when it was assassinated and when Roots came on, those are poignant moments. You remember exactly what you were doing that day and all of the things that led up to it. It was like I was glued to CNN and, you know, I'm from Chicago, so I was watching all this stuff happening at Grant Park and everything. It was just absolutely amazing. And one of the things that happened in the conversation was that, oh, well, guess what? We got our first black president. Racism is no more. He won. Hey, you know, remember Jesse Jackson, keep hope alive. And then, you know, we got Obama talking about change. No. As a result of Obama, I was having this conversation with activist Lay Moonwa, and he was telling me, hey, the racial unrest and crimes against blacks has spiked more than ever in almost the history of America, if you can imagine. Now, we think it was really bad back in the civil rights movement, but we're in a completely new civil rights movement, and they're trying to keep it down, but thank God for cell phones and national news. Can you only imagine what it takes to get to the national news and all the things that never get to the national news that's happening right now as we're speaking?
Yeah.
How do you speak to the new civil rights movement, the new racial unrest in this country as a result having a black president?
Two things occur to me. One, we have to read. We have to constantly be aware and talk to each other. The other is that we got to vote. It's one thing to be aware, but without action, what does it mean? You know, faith without works is dead. You know, we got to vote. And when we vote, that's when we say what we believe, what we want. You know, that's what we as a people stand for. We got to vote. You know, if you've got white officers who are not treating your town well, vote, put in somebody else.
Is it that, and I don't want to be cavalier about that, is it that simple?
I don't mean for it to sound simple at all.
Vote. But it's necessary.
You know, if we vote around this country, that's our voice. That's the way that we are standing up for ourselves.
What you're saying is, because there are kids right now, there are people and adults who feel so disconnected and not a part of America, of society, that they would say, well, why would I vote? Because I'm not treated, and my people are not treated equally and fairly. Why would I? So this is something I'm happy to have the conversation with you, because you're the perfect person to kind of bridge that. And how do you get someone to take that level of ownership to understand the power and really what we fought for, what the civil rights movement was about and what we fought for, to exercise that right to vote?
You know, it's like if we forget that we have that power, you know, our combined power to vote and say what we want for our lives, you know, that's also a disenfranchisement that we're doing to ourselves. I remember during when I was in Columbus, one of the things that Les Brown did was that man with one voice got out there. He got people with buses to go and collect people all around the communities to go and register to vote. And then he made sure that those same buses came by and took those people to vote. Mm. And they felt empowered as a result. And, you know, but if you just sit back and say, well, you know, they ought to do something.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know? They ought to do something.
Gotcha.
You know, get up. You know, I remember that man electrified, that single man electrified an entire town.
I can't wait for Les Brown to find this out. I absolutely know he doesn't know this, that Les Brown inspired Dr. Myran Haley. That's incredible.
Not only me.
That's the motivator. That's why they call him the motivator. He's the motivator of motivators.
Les Brown inspired the chairman of Black Studies. Les Brown inspired the mayor. Les Brown inspired the lady who only had house slippers, not shoes, that she could wear to get on the bus to go vote. Because Les Brown said it was important.
Wow. That
one man made a change. One man.
Wow. Unbelievable.
Not just because he was a broadcaster. Les Brown put himself out there, you know, and said, look, we can't do anything if we don't get up and go do it. You know, and not only he talked about not only voting, he said, you got to go to school. I would be in my car driving to school saying, Les Brown said, I got to go to school. And he said, you have to go to school. I need to get an A. You know, it's like he would say, whatever you can do, not they can do, we can do, whatever you can do. Because if you can make a change, you can change the whole tide, the whole spiritual tide, the whole physical tide. The man, that was his message, and he changed the whole town.
Wow. Well, subsequently, he's also affected the whole world. I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing right now if it wasn't for Les Brown. So he's affected a lot of people positively. When I saw Les Brown on PBS, You Deserve, that was the moment for me. That was a catalyst. That was like your Malcolm X moment, you know. No, I said, oh my God, I never saw a black man doing motivational speak. I never even saw anything like that before. I never even heard the term. When I saw that, I said, that's what I want to do. So yeah, Les Brown, I don't think he really knows how much impact he's had on this country and subsequently the world, because I mean, we wouldn't be talking, you and I, right now if it were not for Les Brown.
Les Brown, let me tell you, he'd sit in our living room. The man would just start, he would just start talking, and people would be falling out from the funny things that he would say. But underneath, if you listened to him, if you really listened to him, it was like you were getting educated, you know? Mm-hmm. And he'd be there with the, he had the afro with the comb sticking up in the back of his head, you know?
And, he probably didn't want you to remember that much detail.
He'd be eating mama's spaghetti, you know?
Oh, my goodness.
Les was just an incredible man. He was simple, though. I mean, he had his little short sleeve shirt and whatnot. He's sitting in the living room and he's just being one of us. And he's saying, we have got to get up. And then Les started putting himself out on his radio show. It was like people loved him so much that they extended his hours. But then after a while, they got afraid. They got afraid of Les, you know. But it was already happening by then. Les. It was like one man showed us what one person could do.
Mm-hmm.
One person. Mm-hmm. And that was his message. It's not about them, they, out there, we. What can you do?
Speaking of one person, another person that inspired you was, and we just happened to have a conversation about it, and I dropped her name arbitrarily, was my late minister, Reverend Dr. Johnny Coleman. I did not know that you and Alex met new Reverend Dr. Johnny Coleman.
No, I met Dr. Johnny Coleman with Della Reese. Della introduced me to her, and I just found her to be a phenomenal figure. She was absolutely electrifying to me, you know, because she talked about the importance of the individual, you know. Mm. You can do what you can do. But we're talking about those other folks. So what can you do?
Love it. Absolutely love it. All right. So
our responsibility. You can't talk about somebody else.
I appreciate that. And I know we're running out of time. I know you have things to do, but I have to get this out because, you know, we have so much to cover. You have written a phenomenal book. When we last talked, you were on my radio show, we were talking about The Treason of Mary Lou Vester. This was your first fictional novel. Well, it's not somewhat fictional, but it is a little fictional, but it's, you know, it's an amazing story. Talk to us about, tell the world, talk to us about the treason of Mary Lou Vester and that you're working on part two.
Well, The Twins and Mary Lou Wesler is based on a true story about this woman who lived in Norfolk, Virginia around the time of the Civil War in a great peril to herself. She was able to copy the plans of the Merrimack and get them, walk them. She was in her late 40s and walked them at great peril from Norfolk to Washington in one of the worst winters ever of that time. And she was pursued by a man who wanted nothing more than to see her dead.
Wow.
And she got those plans there, and they helped to change the course of the Civil War. Yeah.
How long did it what inspired you to write this?
Alex, I told him that I wanted to write about a book about a woman that I could identify with. And, you know, there are always lots of black women of great significance. But it wasn't until his major researcher, George Sims, found a little nugget about Mary Lou Wesler in the Library of Congress. And once I read that, I was hooked. And, you know, I did the research, and then ultimately, you know, I wrote the novel.
How long did it take you from concept to finished product? How long did it take you to write it?
A long time, because when I first gathered the material, I had to put it down because I was doing so many projects for Alex. And then when Alex died, I thought I would pick it up again. And then right after that, every member of my family proceeded to die of cancer. And so I had to deal with that. And then once that was settled, it was like all of that had congealed and Mary Lou Wesler was in me. And I sat down and wrote it just like that.
When did Alex Haley die?
1992 in February.
You told me that, because I asked you the question, are you in contact with any of the original cast members of Roots? And you said no, and you said only two people showed up to his funeral.
Right. LeVar Burton, I saw across the room. But Cecily was wonderful. Cecily took my hand and
Cecily Tyson. Yeah.
She walked with me into the church, and she said, "If you ever need me, you call me." You know, and I truly believe that she meant that then and now. You know, I do. Yeah. And you asked me to read to you a portion of Mary Lou Wesler.
Yes, please.
Mary, and this portion is Mary was trying to copy the plans, and how difficult it was for her. Okay. That morning's foray was taut, but easy enough. She had copied a good portion of the plans. The next day, Mary hoped her efforts would go as smoothly. She'd chosen to dress now in a black outfit made on the order of men's cotton pajamas. She liked that she had an ease of movement in them. She arrived at the study door with no trouble, but when she tried to turn the knob, it didn't move. She jiggled the handle. It failed to turn. It was locked. Why? She wondered. As quickly as possible, she made her way to the kitchen. The house keys hung on a large ring just inside the swinging doors. A dozen keys passed through her fingers, but not one of them looked like the skeleton key for the study. She went through the keys again and again to make sure that she hadn't overlooked what it was that she was after. Exasperated, she gave up and stealthily returned to her room. Simeon got back from Richmond way late last night, Rogan the cook told Mary a little later on after breakfast. He's going to go back to the tannery tomorrow. He wants me to pack him some lunch. Mary knew that she needed to copy as much as possible before he left. Outside, under cover of the huge oak tree, she studied the office window. She silently examined the veranda and the window ledge. She hoped Simeon had left the window unlocked. He usually did, but she imagined the raccoon might make him resort to securing it. Still, it was her only possibility. Her instinct said the prudent thing to do was hurry. A deep breath, and quickly she was on the veranda, the window sash in both hands, and with persistent tugging, she lifted it out. Another instant saw her hoisting herself up to the ledge and pressing herself inside. The moccasins on her feet sounded only a tiny thump as she hopped from the windowsill to the floor, but the pain in her knee lanced hotly. Her fingers were fast as soon as she found the sheaf of ship's plans where she had left off before. One square of tracing paper, sketch, fold, tuck it in her bosom. Another piece of paper, sketch, fold, tuck. Only one more large sheet of renderings to go. Needlessly, she fingered the stack of supply papers in the pouch that she carried on her hip. It was a nervous gesture, since she made sure that she had plenty of pieces of the tracing paper before she left out. Wait, what was that? She cocked her ear. She heard a key turn in the office door, lock. Mary launched herself to the back of the room. There was no time to get back through the window. If whoever was coming had a lamp, it would be impossible not to see her, even in a large room such as this. Her eyes swung around desperately, seeking a place to hide. As the door began to open, she spotted a small space between the two bookcases. Panic raced through her. She saw she left the plans open on the desk, and a small square of tracing paper lay on top. In addition, she had left the window open to make sure she had means of exit if she had to. Her mind raced. She knew this little oversight could derail everything. She edged out of the space and down on all fours. She crawled toward the door, mimicking the low, guttural sound of an animal. She desperately hoped that whoever was at the door would fear it was to be the raccoon had returned. It now was on the attack. The door slammed shut. Mary wanted to laugh, but she had no time. She grabbed up her tracing paper, dashed to the window, and burst through it. She fell to the veranda with a thud and came up on her knees, grabbing her walking stick. She left, leaning against the wall and tore away. She ran as best she could back to the safety of the oak tree. From behind it, she peered and watched, panting as Tesh Lucienne emerged from the side porch, lantern in hand, swinging in arcs of light. In the hush of the early morning, Mary could hear her singing her words like the blubbering from the mouth of a drunk. Come out, come out. Whoever you are, come out, come out. Whoever you are, Tesh Lucienne hiccuped and giggled. She then wandered the length of the porch and burrowed into the comfy pillows of a chair. She dug a bottle from her robe pocket. Okay, she slurred. I'll just take a sip of this and I'll wait for you. I'll just have a little more liberation till you get back. She slugged back a big drink, then clasped the bottle to her chest. Don't know what I ever would have done without the slaughter. She held up the bottle, squinting, but unable to read the label. No matter to me what it is, just works for me. Mary stood stock still for how long she didn't know. Sun was beginning to peer through the trees when her sore muscles told her it was safe to move. Tesh Lucienne had laid her head back and now moved in uneasy slumber. When Mary felt it was safe, she hurried across the open lawn to the steps to the kitchen door. Just before she headed up them, though, she realized that Rogie would be up and at work. Mary hunched low and waddled like a duck along the base of the veranda on the other side of the house to avoid being seen. Holding her stick in her hand, she bent to her knees and powered upward in a jump. On the count of three, her hand caught a narrow ledge and she pulled herself up to the veranda. Her muscles screamed from the pain and she wanted to scream as well, panting and sweating. She inched up and to grasp the spindles of the veranda. Ballister, she grunted through them. For a moment, she lay there panting on the smooth, white-painted, wide porch. And as soon as she caught her breath, she pushed through the French doors into her salon. Rogi the cook was at the sideboard with her cart setting out food for the day's clients, and she turned and caught sight of the disheveled Mary. Wild-eyed and breathing hard, Mary stood back and looked at the cook. Rogi shook her head. I ain't go ax.
You are amazing. You know that, right? So Oprah, Tyler Perry, somebody with some money, take this book and turn this into a miniseries as well. You know, that's really what you do. I mean, that's your thing. I mean, I'm riveted. I'm like in it. I'm like, what's going to happen next? This is exactly how Roots was. I mean, that's exactly, you write just, it's so emotional and visual. It's like you're right there and you're in the moment. My goodness. Okay, what's next for you? What are you, I mean, you know, huh?
There are six in this series of the Mary the Bester, and they come all the way across time to present day, and where we examine the black super wealthy of this country who in fact have major power that we know very little about. And I write about them in the sixth book.
You gotta finish this. How soon will all of this be ready? And when will you be sending me all of the copies and everything like you used to do with Alex? Because I want to read everything first.
Well, all six of them have been mapped out. And I'm just about finished with the second one. But they will all come across time. And so that we see the progression of blacks who were not sharecroppers. They came through the West as entrepreneurs. And they became our... life insurance agent, our real estate agent, our music.
Wow.
They came, you know, and I bring them all the way through Chicago, New York, excuse me, and end up in Washington with the elite.
That is nobody ever knows that story, that side. Oh my God, that's incredible.
I'm sorry.
That's important for us to know.
I just wrote a screenplay about the super rich blacks in this country, and it's called Strutter's Ball. I have just submitted it to a studio. I hope they pick it up.
I pray to God they do. If they don't, I'm going to pick somebody up and make them pick it up. I swear to God. I love you. We have run out of time, but okay. We have made some great time and spent it wisely and very well in logging and collecting this history. You have to come back on the show, and we have to do this again and again and again and again. So this is just going to be a part of your regular life. You'll just be seeing me all the time. I might even have you on every day at some point, just coming on like, hey, what you doing? I'm talking to my, and that's what we're doing. I love you so much. Thank you so much for sharing your history and your life with me.
Thank you. Love you.
Love you too.
All right.
Stick around in the green room. Don't go anywhere as we sign off. Thanks everybody for tuning in to this edition of the Philippe Matthews Show, wherever you are around the world. We thank you. We love you. Thank you for being a part of sharing and viewing this history. And please share this, pass it on, allow your children to watch it with your children. And don't forget to watch Roots when it comes back on. And also, why don't you watch the original miniseries? You can get it downloaded anywhere from YouTube to Amazon.com. It's something that you have to do, especially if you're African-American. But if you're not African-American, you need to know the story as well. So you understand what we are fighting for, what we are dealing with, and why we are here doing this work.
Read the book.
Yes, read the book. Absolutely. God bless everybody.